We are discussing the notion of the adjoint. Okay. We have seen that the adjoint exists for any operator over a finite dimensional inner product space. Let us look at some properties of this adjoint. Remember the correlation between similarities between the adjoint and the operation of complex conjugation. Okay. I told you that they are similar. The following result will tell you why this is so. So I have the following theorem which lists the properties of the adjoint operator. Let V be a finite dimensional inner product space. T, U be linear operators, then the following properties hold. First one is, if you look at T plus U, T plus U star, this is T star plus U star. Property 2, look at alpha times T star, this is alpha bar T star. Property 3, look at T U star, that is U star T star. And property 4 is that this operation of taking the adjoint is an operation of period 2. You do it 2 times, you get the same operator T. Okay. Proof is to just verify the basic equation. For the first one, you look at T plus U x comma y, T and U are linear, so, and this addition, that is also a linear operation, that is I can split this as T x comma y plus U x comma y, that is x comma T star y plus x comma U star y. This is possible because T and U have adjoints, it is a finite dimensional inner product space. This can be written as x comma T star y plus U star y, that is T star plus U star of y. Now the definition of adjoint is, if you have Lxy equals x comma My, then M is equal to L star. Lxy equals x comma M, x comma My, then M is equal to L star, that is T star plus U star is T plus T whole star. That is the first one. Okay. Second one similar. So second one I leave. The thing is, for the second it is a conjugate, it will come with the conjugate. Let me prove the third one. So second is straightforward, third is also straightforward, but I will prove it in any case. You consider what is the order in which I take TU x comma y. TU x comma y is T, this is a composition. Okay, so that is T of UX comma y, then this is UX comma T star y, that is the definition of T star. This goes here, it goes with the conjugate. Apply it once again, x U star T star y. When I write U star T star, it is the composition of these linear maps. So what is the meaning of this? X, but this left hand side is, okay, just to emphasize, the left hand side is x comma t u star y, and so 3 holds. We have shown that t u star is u star t star. This is called the reverse order law for the adjoint operation, similar to the reverse order law for the usual transpose, transpose of linear transformations that we studied earlier, similar to the operation of taking transpose for matrices, similar to the operation of taking conjugate transpose for complex matrices. So that's property 3. Property 4. You look at Tx comma y. Okay, I want to show T double star. Right. So let me start with T double star. This time, T double star x equals y. This is by definition when it goes here, one star is removed. One star actually appears, so the problem becomes complicated. So what I'll do is I'll start with T star x. I'll start with T star x comma y. This is x comma T y. Which is what I want to prove. So that's x comma t star star y, but the left hand side is x comma t. Left hand side is x comma t y. Right hand side is x comma something y. Okay, we don't know, but
using bar you can prove this.
Okay, this much we know. Left hand side is y comma t star x conjugate. Okay, this is t star x comma y. Y comma t star x conjugate, which is the conjugate of t y comma x, which is the same as x comma t y. That's the left answer. Okay. Yeah. So that needed explanation. So x comma t y is x comma t double star y. So from this, this is true for all x and y. It follows that t star star is t. Okay. So just to list some properties. Now you will see that the reason why this adjoint operation is compared to the operation of complex conjugation. If you have z1 and z2 two complex numbers, then z1 plus z2 bar, z1 bar plus z2 bar, z1. Okay, look at this. Constant times z is the constant times bar into z bar, and look at this. This is z1 z2 bar. Their complex multiplication is commutative, so you don't have to impose this rule. Okay, this is just a t star u star there, if you want. And when you do it twice, z bar bar is z. Okay. What is also to be compared for an operator is the following. For an operator, you can think of a real part and an imaginary part using the adjoint operation. So let me just illustrate that and then move on to unitary operators. So if T is an operator on a finite dimensional inner product space V, then I can write T as u1 plus I u2, u1 plus I u2, where u1 is T plus T star by 2, and u2 is T minus T star by 2. Okay, you can verify this. Now u1 and u2 are unique because t star is unique, and you can also observe that u1 has the property that u1 is its own adjoint. It's a self adjoint operator. What about u2? U2, is that self adjoint?
Minus of u2 star.
It is, see, this is called Hermitian. So what is the thing with U2? Skew Hermitian. So U2 star is minus U2. You can just check these calculations. So there is a kind of a U1 star is U1, is what I want to say. Yes, U2 star is minus U2. U1 is self-adjoint. So this is just to tell you that any operator on a possibly complex finite dimensional inner product space can be written as a real part and an imaginary part. Now U1 is self-adjoint, so that's a kind of a real part we talk about. Why is it the real part? For instance, a complex number is real if and only if z bar is equal to z. Z bar is equal to z. So what is real about this? The thing that's in the mind when one says that this is a kind of a real part is the following. Any self-adjoint operator satisfies the following. In particular, this U1 satisfies the following. U1 x comma x. This is real for all x element of V. So that's what we have in our mind when we say that this is a kind of a real part. U1 x comma x is real for all x in V. Whenever U1 star is U1, in fact, the converse is also true. The converse is also true. First, U1 star equal to U1 implies U1 x comma x. See, this is a kind of a quadratic form. U1 x comma x is a quadratic form. So if U1 is self-adjoint, then this is real. That's straightforward. The converse will use polarization identity. So I'm going to leave that as an exercise. I will discuss polarization identity a little later. But the converse is also true. T is self-adjoint if and only if Tx comma x is real. Okay. Okay. Why are self-adjoint operators important? This is a self-adjoint operator. The real part U1 is a self-adjoint operator. Self-adjoint operators are important for one single reason, which is that there exists an orth. If T is a self-adjoint operator on a finite dimensional inner product space V, then there exists an orthonormal basis of V, each of whose vector is an eigenvector for T. Okay, so this is saying this is the same as saying that T can be diagonalized by means of a unitary matrix. I'll explain these terms later, but this is just a kind of a prelude. Any self-adjoint operator on a finite dimensional inner product space V has a property that there is an orthonormal basis of V, each of whose vectors is an eigenvector for T. Okay, this is another very important property that a self-adjoint operator satisfies. So this is just to kind of relate the notion of the adjoint with the conjugate operation for a complex number. Let's look at this further. Look at subclasses of operators which satisfy certain other properties with regard to the adjoint. Okay, one of them is a unitary operator. But before discussing unitary operators, I want to discuss the notion of isomorphism between inner product spaces. Okay, using the operation of star, I want to discuss the notion of a unitary operator. But before that, isomorphism between inner product spaces. Let V be an inner product space, not necessarily finite dimensional. And T be a linear operator on V. Then T is said to preserve the inner product. Said to be inner product preserving. If T satisfies the following. Inner product of Tx with Ty. It's the same as inner product x with y. This is true for all xy in V. T is set to preserve the inner product if this equation holds. Okay, this leads to the definition of an isomorphism. Remember, isomorphism between vector spaces is a one-one. It's a linear injective surjective map, okay, linear bijection. For inner product spaces, the extra requirement is that it must be inner product preserving. Okay. An isomorphism. So isomorphism means same structure, right? Morphism is structure, iso is the same. In addition to this being a bijective linear map, it has got to do with vector inner product spaces V and W, for instance. So it must preserve the inner product also. That relation should also come. An isomorphism, I will say now, between an isomorphism on an inner product space. An isomorphism on an inner product space is a linear bijective inner product preserving map. Is a linear bijective inner product preserving map. Linear bijective map which preserves inner product. Okay. Before I go to characterizing isomorphism between inner product spaces, let me tell you one property that an inner product preserving map must satisfy. I'll give examples a little later, but there is one property that this inner product preserving linear transformation must satisfy in relation to the norm. There is a relationship with the inner product. This should lead to a relationship between norms. So that is the following. So I'll state this as a lemma. Let T be an inner product preserving linear map, linear operator on V. V is an inner product space, not necessarily finite dimension. Any inner product, this is a definition also, you will see, for a general inner product space. Then norm of Tx equals norm of X for all X and V. We say in this case that it is an isometric. Norm of Tx equals norm X for all X and V. The converse is also true. The converse also holds. So if T is an isometric linear, then we can show that it will preserve the inner products. Remember that this norm is a norm induced by that inner product. Okay. Whenever we talk about a norm in an inner product space in this course, so this is a norm induced by that inner product. Okay. One way the proof is easy. If it preserves the inner product, then it preserves a norm is easy. So necessity. Look at norm Tx square. This is inner product Tx with Tx. That's what I told you, that this is a norm induced by this inner product. But T is the inner product preserving, so this is inner product X comma X. That is norm X square. You take the positive square root, you get, okay, these are non-negative numbers, you get T is norm preserving. Okay. So norm Tx is norm X. For the converse, you need a little work, which is actually to first prove the polarization identities. So for the converse sufficiency, we first observe, but we can quickly see the proof also. Observe that the polarization identities. Hold. Polarization identities hold. So, what is this one for real, one for the complex case? V is a real inner product space. In this case, the polarization identity is inner product xy equals 1 by 4. Norm x plus y square minus one by four norm x minus y square. When it is real, for a complex inner product space, it's a little more complicated. V is a complex inner product space. Then the polarization identity takes this form. You can guess the next two terms. I by 4 norm x plus I y the whole square minus I by 4 norm x minus I y the whole square. These hold for all x, y. Out of which, let me prove. See, what you can do is, in order to prove this, look at the right hand side, expand by the inner product, and you will get the left hand side. For example, norm x plus y square is inner product x plus y comma x plus y. That is norm x square plus 2 times real part of x comma y plus norm y square. When you subtract, the 2 times real part will go. Sorry, it goes with a minus sign for the second term. So that's the only term which will remain. 2 plus 2, 4, that 4 will get cancelled with this. So it's simple verification proof. So I will not get into the proof of this, that's really straightforward. Using I'll prove it for the case when V is real, that if it preserves the norm, then it must preserve the inner product. Okay, complex case is similar. So let us take the case when V is real. I want to show that inner product Tx Ty is x comma y. So let me start with inner product Tx Ty. This by definition is 1 by 4 norm of Tx plus Ty the whole square minus 1 by 4 norm of Tx minus Ty the whole square. I am assuming, I am proving the sufficiency part. I am assuming that T preserves the norm. I will show that T preserves the inner product. This is 1 by 4 norm of T of x plus y, T is linear, minus 1 by 4 norm of T x minus y. Use the fact that T preserves the norm. So this first term is 1 by 4 norm of x plus y square. That is norm of Tx equals norm of x, so norm of Tx square is norm of x square, minus 1 by 4 norm of x minus y square. The real polarization identity tells you that this is inner product x comma y. So T preserves the inner products. Okay, so if it is inner product preserving, then it must be norm preserving and conversely. I have proved it for the real case, complex case is similar. So let us now look at necessary sufficient conditions for a linear transformation to be an isomorphism between inner product spaces. By the way, I do not have to write, two inner product spaces V and W are said to be isomorphic. Inner product space is said to be isomorphic if there is an isomorphism between the inner product space. Isomorphism is not just a vector space isomorphism, it must also preserve the inner products. Okay, then this relation is an equivalence relation. V is isomorphic to itself by means of the identity map. V isomorphic to W means W is isomorphic to V by means of the inverse transformation. Inverse exists because T is bijective. Inverse is linear because T is linear. Inverse preserves inner product because T preserves inner product. That takes a little observation, but it can be done. And again, if V is isomorphic to W, W isomorphic to Z, then V is isomorphic to Z through the composition map. Okay, so that's quickly. It's an equivalence relation. Isomorphism between vector spaces is an equivalence relation. But let's look at the following result, which gives isomorphism in by means of other conditions. So I have the following result. You must compare this theorem with a corresponding result that we proved for vector spaces, finite dimensional vector spaces, where we characterized isomorphisms. So here we have finite dimensional inner product spaces. Let V and W be inner products, finite dimensional inner product spaces over the same field, such that dimension of V is equal to dimension of W, and I am assuming that V is a finite dimensional inner product space. So V and W are finite dimensional inner product spaces with the same dimension. For a linear map T from V into W, the following conditions are equal. The following conditions are equal. Okay, so same dimension. The following conditions are equal. The first condition is okay, I'll call it A. T preserves inner product. Just this much. T preserves inner product. Dimension V is dimension W. Condition 2. T is an isomorphism. To emphasize, it's an inner product space isomorphism. Second is apparently stronger than the first one, but under in this framework these are the same, these are equivalent conditions. So T is an isomorphism where I am just emphasizing that it must be an inner product space isomorphism. Condition C, for every orthonormal basis of V, let me list the elements. For every orthonormal basis, okay, just write down the elements u1, u2, etc., un. For every orthonormal basis, this of V, it holds that tu1, etc., tun is an orthonormal basis of W. Now this you must compare this, I told you, with the vector space isomorphism. It will not be an orthonormal basis, it will be just a basis. Okay, you include orthonormality because there is an inner product here. So it holds that tu1, tu2, etc., tun, see I am given that the dimensions are the same. Okay. It holds that this is an orthonormal basis. Of W. For every orthonormal basis, we may call this an image. This is an orthonormal basis. Apparently, weaker is condition D, which says for some orthonormal basis, v1, okay, I'll use the same u1, u2, etc., un of v. Tu1, Tu2, etc., Tun is an orthonormal basis of W. Condition D looks weaker than condition C, but in this framework they are the same, the conditions are equivalent. Okay, so let us prove this. Again, as before, we will prove A implies B, B implies C, C implies D, D implies A. A implies B. T preserves inner product. So you can give the proof. So tell me. T preserves inner product. I must show that it is a nice inner product space isomorphism. So I need to show that it is bijective, that is all. Okay. How does that follow? Dimensions are the same, is to be used. But how do you prove it is bijective? That is the only thing left. You need to show T is bijective. Okay. Null space is 0. So how do you show that null space is 0? Preserves inner product, okay. Yeah, you can use that. Norm Px equal to 0 implies x, norm x equal to 0. Just use that. So that is the first part. Only to show T is bijective, okay. Sufficient to show, we must show that T is bijective, but sufficient to show that T is injective. Sufficient to show that T is injective because the dimensions are the same. By rank nullity dimension theorem, it follows that it is injective only if it is surjective. T is injective, but then we know that, but since T preserves inner product, we have that T preserves norm. So norm of Tx equals norm x for all x in V. So Tx equal to 0 implies norm x equal to 0, it implies x equal to 0, and so null space of T is singleton 0, and so T is injective, so T is bijective. So B holds, it is in fact invertible, that is what B says. B implies C. For every orthonormal basis, we must show that this image is also an orthonormal basis of W. What is given is that T is an inner product space isomorphism. I must show that. Okay, let me just write down. Given that orthonormal basis u1, etc., un, I must show that tu1, tu2, etc., tun is an orthonormal of W. But why is it a basis for W?
Why don't
you just give me one word? One word.
T is an isomorphism.
Over. T is an isomorphism. B implies C. T is an isomorphism. So this must be a basis. We want to show it's extra. It's an orthonormal basis. See, T is an isomorphism. So this is a u1, u2, etc., un is a basis, implies tu1, tu, etc., tun is a basis to begin with. So first of all, this is basis. First, this is a basis. I need to show it is orthonormal, but just use the fact that it preserves in a product. So just look at Tui comma Tuj. I must show that this is equal to delta ij. Then it follows that it's an orthonormal basis. But this is by definition Ui comma Uj because it preserves in a product. Ui Uj, I started with this as an orthonormal basis. So this is delta ij, the Kronecker delta. So this proves that this set of vectors Tun etc. Tun forms an orthonormal basis of W. That's B implies C. C implies D. There is no need for the proof. If it holds for every orthonormal basis, it must also hold for some orthonormal basis. So only thing is D implies A. So C implies D. There is nothing trivial. D implies A. For some orthonormal basis Un etc., this is an orthonormal basis. If this is satisfied, then I must show that T preserves in a product. Okay. Let me just write down the condition D. There exists an orthonormal basis of V such that Tu1, Tu2, etc., Tun is an orthonormal basis I know this. I must show that T preserves the inner product. Muthukumar, you wanted to say something? C is stronger than D. Is that okay? So C implies D is straightforward. Okay. So I am just proving D implies A. Okay. How do I go about proving this? I must show that inner product Tx comma Ty equals inner product x comma y for all xy. Okay, so we have to take recourse to that. Let us take x as x is a linear combination of I will take xy in V. I must show that inner product xy equals Tx inner product Tx comma Ty. They are in V, they can be written in terms of these, and I also know what the coefficients must be. I will call the coefficients x1 etc. xn, y1 etc. yn, because they correspond to x and y. So I have the following representation: x equals x1 u1 plus x2 u2 etc. plus xn un. I know what these coefficients must be. Y will be y1 u1 plus y2 u2 etc. So we need to use the linearity of T. So you write x and y in terms of these basis vectors. What is the inner product of x with y? Let us calculate that. Let me use a summation notation here. This is summation, what do I use? I equals 1 to n xi ui. This is summation j equals 1 to n yi ui. Sorry, yj uj. I need to calculate this. So can I just write down now? We have seen this several times. I equals 1 to n xi, j equals 1 to n yj, inner product ui uj, yj bar, okay. But you see what is going on. We started with an orthonormal basis. The outer the inner summation is for j, and for the inner summation I is fixed. So when j takes the value I, it is 1, all other terms are 0. J takes the value I, this becomes yi bar. So this is just summation I equals 1 to n xi yi bar. Something that is similar to Cn, for instance. something that this is precisely the inner product in CN with respect to the standard orthonormal basis. Okay, let's calculate Tx Ty similarly. Consider Tx. Okay, let me write down Tx. Tx will be summation I equals 1 to n xi t of ui, and Ty is summation j equals 1 to n yj t of uj. I take the inner product, compute, show that it is the same as this. So inner product Tx Ty is again I will reduce the calculations. I equals 1 to n xi, j equals 1 to n yj bar, inner product Tui Tuj. Again the same thing, Tui Tuj, that is part of an orthonormal basis. When j takes the value I, it is 1, all other terms are 0 because that is an orthonormal basis. So this is again I equal to 1 to n xi yi bar. So A holds. So T preserves inner product. If you know that T is a linear transformation which takes some orthonormal basis to some orthonormal basis of V to an orthonormal basis of W. Dimension W equals dimension of V. Okay. An easy corollary. I am going to leave that as an exercise for you. Let V, W be finite dimensional inner product spaces. Finite dimensional inner product spaces. Then V is isomorphic to W, where its isomorphism of inner product spaces between inner product spaces. Then V is isomorphic to W if and only if dimension V equals dimension W. I will not write down the proof, I want you to tell me how it goes. There are two parts. Suppose V is isomorphic to W as inner product spaces, then dimension V equals dimension W. How does it follow? See, there exists an inner product space isomorphism from V into W, but that must be in the first place a vector space isomorphism. But we know vector spaces, when they are isomorphic and they are finite dimension, the dimensions must coincide. One way. Converse, suppose dimension V equals dimension W, finite dimensional spaces, I must show that V is isomorphic to W. That is all, I must exhibit an isomorphism. So take an orthonormal basis of V, take an orthonormal basis of W. Orthonormal basis of V, we can call it V1 etc. Vn, for W, W1 etc. Wn, define a map T which takes Vi to Wi. Then you can show that it is linear, bijective, preserves inner product. Okay, so this is an easy corollary of the previous result. Before I stop, let's look at two examples, one over finite dimensional spaces, another one over infinite dimensional spaces, inner product preserving maps, product preserving linear maps. Okay, I told you two examples. The first one is I'll take V to be R3 with the usual inner product, W to be the subspace of the space of all 3 by 3 real matrices that are skew symmetric, that are skew symmetric, space of all real skew symmetric matrices of order 3. I want you to tell me the dimension of W. What do you expect the dimension of W to be first? I want to give example of inner product space isomorphisms. So what do you expect the dimension of W to be? 3. Okay. Can you show it's 3? How? A transpose equals A. See, a matrix of order 3, a square matrix of order 3 has 9 independent elements, 9 independent ways of filling the elements, the entries of A. A transpose equal to minus A makes sure the diagonals are 0. So 3 conditions are gone. I need 6 independent, apparently 6 independent conditions. Can I reduce it to 3? Skew symmetric. Transpose is minus A, so just fix up either the upper part or the lower part, the other part is determined. So dimension W is 3. Okay. I define a map T from V to W by T of the vector X. Take a vector X. How do I fill it up as a matrix in such a way that I get a skew symmetric matrix? The definition is it must be skew symmetric, the diagonal entries must be 0. So 0, 0, 0. This is minus X3, this is minus X2, this is X1, this is negative, X3 minus X1, X2. Okay. Then it is an easy exercise to see that T is linear. Dimension of V is the same as dimension of W. So in order to show that it is it's invertible, bijective, it is enough if I show null space is singleton 0. Can you see that? Null space of T must be singleton 0. So T is injective, dimensions are the same, T is bijective. I only need to show that T is an inner product space. Till now I have only vector spaces. I will endow R3 with the usual inner product, endow W with the following inner product. For two matrices in W, the inner product is defined as 1 by 2 times trace of AB transpose. This is not new. This is not new. It is just trace of B star A if you want. The extra thing is 1 by 2. You will realize why it is why that constant 1 by 2 appears there. Given two matrices AB in W, okay, I will leave it as an exercise for you to verify that. Inner product xy over R3, the usual inner products tx comma ty. So please verify, this is just elementary calculation. You calculate AB transpose and look at the trace, it will be 2 times the usual inner product. That is the reason why this 1 by 2 is taken, to cancel out the 2. Okay, finite dimensional case, this is an inner product space isomorphism. Just an example, in the infinite dimensional case, it is inner product preserving but not an isomorphism. Example 2, I will take V to be C 0 1, a real value. Real valued continuous functions over the interval 0 1 with this inner product. It will be 0 to 1 f of t g of t together with a weight t square. Okay, so I will include a weight t square, any positive weight can be included. So this is an inner product on V. W is the same space, C 0 1 real valued continuous function over 0 1 with a usual inner product. Same space with the usual inner product. Define the mapping T from V to W by T of F, continuous function F at T. So TF at T is T times F of T. T times F of T. Then you can show that this T is linear, it is inner product preserving. This T will come 2 times. First argument, second argument, so this t square comes out. Okay, so you can check that this t is inner product preserving. Inner product preserving linear map. It's an inner product preserving linear map. Is T invertible? TF equal to 0, does it imply F equal to 0? Of course, TF equal to 0 of course implies F equal to 0. T is injective, T is not bijective. T is not bijective because take the constant function 1, take the constant function 1 and W. The question is, does there exist a function small f such that T times f of t equal to 1? Does there exist a continuous function f such that f of t equals 1 by t? So T is injective but not bijective. So please check this. So T is an inner product preserving linear map, injective but not bijective. Okay. See, I am emphasizing this example because see, remember we have shown that if T is, if dimension V equals dimension W and if T is inner product preserving, then it is invertible. Okay. That does not happen here because we are over infinite dimension spaces. That is the purpose of this example. The result that we proved earlier holds for finite dimensional spaces. Dimension V equals dimension W finite. It is the same space. W equals V, same space. Inner products are different. Okay. So this is injective, inner product preserving, but not bijective, but not onto, but not surjective. Okay. Let me stop. See, I want a continuous function f of t such that t f of t equal to 0 for all t. The only way that can happen is f is 0.